So hello, everybody. Welcome, and thank you very much for joining us tonight. I want to say thank you, first of all, to everybody who's here and who has come to listen to our two wonderful keynote speakers and our discussant this evening. But I want to say a special thank you to Professor Rance Lee, who was extremely generous in welcoming us to the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And I just want to say a special thank you to you. So thank you very much. And he's going to come up here and give us some welcoming remarks.
Professor Sophia Chen, and Undersecretary for Food and Health, chairpersons of the forum, Dr. Suvika Bhutta and Dr. M. Marston, chairpersons of Hong Kong Workshop, Dr. Albert Lee and Dr. Andy Shin, distinguished forum members, speakers, guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of our Wu Yi San College, I would like to extend my warmest welcome to all of you, to our college campus, and also the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And for overseas delegates, I would say most welcome to come and visit our Hong Kong society. It is a great honor that our college could work in partnership with the Institute of Medicine of the United States to host this important workshop. For the forum on investing in children globally. Our Wu Yi San College is also known, it's our publicity name, it's also known as the Sunny College. I hope that from now on, we could bring sunshine for all the children around the world, not just for our students. I should take this opportunity to explain that the Chinese University has a total of 9 colleges. Our college system is to complement the academic training, the very specialized academic training by various faculties and departments in providing students with comprehensive whole person education and pastoral care so that they can become able leaders of the society in the many years ahead. Different colleges have somewhat different missions. Our college, Wu Yi San College, is the youngest college of the university. Our mission is to promote entrepreneurial spirit with social responsibility. The college creates and provides an intimate and dynamic learning atmosphere so the students can develop their passion for creativity and innovation and would pursue new ideas, not just for their own personal gains, but also for the welfare of the community. The goal of this forum for investing in children globally fits very well with our educational mission. As this forum would no doubt inspire innovative ideas about how we should and could invest in our younger generations strategically. I'm a medical sociologist. I'm very much concerned about the emerging health issues facing our younger generations, including communicable and non-communicable diseases, as well as mental health and injuries. I'm very pleased and even grateful that Professor Dr. Albert Lee has joined our college and will soon become a fellow of the college. Professor Lee is now working with a team of medical students during their clinical years to use a school and community setting as a platform to promote better child health. The knowledge, ideas and knowledge generated by this forum and workshops will certainly inspire us to design ideas, inspire us to have new ideas to design the program, making it more innovative and more beneficial for children, not just in Hong Kong, but also elsewhere around the world. Finally, I wish to workshop every success, and we sincerely look forward to continue working closely with the Institute of Medicine on this important subject for the betterment of child health. And no less importantly, I wish you all enjoy your time at our Chinese University and also in Hong Kong. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Lee. And I think we're going to get to know, I'm Albert Lee, all right? I'm one of the co-chair together with Dr. Andy Shi for the Hong Kong workshop. So I think we get on to the keynote and the speech, and I would like to briefly introduce the first keynote speaker, my great friend, Dr. C.P. Chow, who is quite well, is a well-known, very experienced, I will use a pediatrician in Hong Kong, and I've been working closely with him. I would just summarize, an important thing is Dr. Chow, although I've known CP for many years, I know he's emerging, fighting for the rights of children. He's been on the chairman for the Committee for Children's Rights, Early Childhood Development Foundation, Children's Playwrights, some of you will visit on Monday, and Childhood Injury Prevention. He's a really advocacy for children's rights. Apart from advocacy, he's a very experienced clinician and a very dedicated doctor, as well as also researchers. And although he's basically a very practicing clinician, he published more than 150 papers and written a lot of books and chapters and on different areas, and from uterine growth problem among Chinese infants to injury prevention and child abuse. So I think I'm sure we will have a lot of interesting discussion after CB and also another my friend Hillary's presentation. So I'd like to call on CB to give our first presentation. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Albert. So, in fact, I'm only a simple retired pediatrician, right? So, the sole reason I was asked to talk this evening, probably because I know Albert, and also I'm old enough, right? So in fact, before I start, probably I need to dedicate my talk to all the people here, right? Especially the colleagues from Hong Kong, right? The sole reason because they have worked so hard, right? That's why later on, probably you can see the good statistics we have in Hong Kong. And also all the colleagues coming from abroad, right? For your dedication and contribution to the welfare of children. Right, so my interest in early childhood probably stemmed from the book from Jack Shankoff, From Neuron to Neighborhood. And subsequently in 2003, I met him in Hawaii, and since then probably been working on early childhood. Right, this is from Institute of Medicine, timing investment and all that. Right, so before this forum, probably you all know there's two reports coming from this. Right, one is on the cost of inaction. Right, to me probably it's very important. The second one is on financing, right, how in India. Right, because of many of you probably may not know Hong Kong that well, so probably I will use a few minutes to introduce Hong Kong, right? So eventually I will talk about one of the programs Australia is here, right? So Comprehensive Child Development Service, and also some of the other aspects. My interest has been for the past 25 years been working on injuries, right? And I'll probably talk a bit about that. Right, firstly, Hong Kong is a highly densely populated area. And also in Hong Kong, 75% of the country is country park. That means that you cannot build a lot of housing or whatever there. And also because of that, probably you can see all the high rises in Hong Kong. Right, so, and also Hong Kong, 50% are living in public housing, right? So this may be good. And the government is saying that probably eventually 60% will be in public housing. But probably from the map, you can see that most of the highly densely populated areas are in the new towns, right? And also, what they are most deprived area. What about the statistics in Hong Kong, right? Probably our statistics probably is impeccable, right? So our fertility rate is not so good, right? So at time, I argue we should be at 0.9, right? So all along, it has been less than 1. And our infant mortality rate probably is one of the best in the world. Similarly, for the under 5 mortality. And our unintentional mortality rate, again, is lowest in the world, right? It's better than Netherlands. But then our intentional injury mortality probably is in the middle. The life expectancy and for male and female probably is the longest, right? We surpass Japan for female and also for the male. The education. Right, so the recent paper from The Economist, Education Index, Hong Kong ranked 19, right? But then in Asia, probably is the first. You look at the Tim Sapples and all that, Hong Kong all along has been quite good, right? In the top 3 or something like that. And recently, Shanghai and also Korea is catching up. Right, so socioeconomic, right? Probably you will see the rich and poor divide is increasing rapidly. Right, our GDP is ranking 14, but then children living in poverty is around 20%. Right, so we're just a bit better than that of the United States of around 23%. Right, so and also the Guinness population has been increasing. Right, so but then of course we have a lot of problems from the new immigrants. Right, so this is the poverty map from the past 5 years coming from the recent poverty report. You can see the Guinea coefficient has been increasing. And Hong Kong is ranking similar to that to Chile on the Guinea coefficient. All right, so worse than that, Japan. And you can see that the deprivation is mainly in the new town. You can see the red one, all of them are almost 100% deprived. So you can see that Hong Kong, although we enjoy a very good statistics, but then poverty, the rich and poor divide is increasing. This study is coming from the London School of Economics, and they have found that the mortality rate between the most deprived and also the least deprived, and the difference can be 2 or 3-fold, right? So that's the thing we're seeing. And similarly for external causes, right? Injuries and all that, right? This is coming from Professor Rao, right? So we can see that the early development, there's also a gap between the working class and the higher class. Probably the education system are acting as an equalizer, right? So we close this up a bit, right? So whether they will continue, I don't know. So we have all those data on the Hong Kong poverty situation, like the in some people, the elderly poverty rate is not that bad, right? We have all those data helping us. One of the major problems, again, we are seeing in Hong Kong is the aging population. So in fact, the dependent ratio in 2012 probably is the lowest. But then by 2041, right, so the dependent rate will almost double, triple. And in 2041, this is will be the population pyramid, right? So we can see that it will easily crumble because we don't have enough children. So that's why probably we need to invest in children, right? To me, that's the most important part. So the system in Hong Kong, probably we have a lot of information, but then all the data are not linked. Right, you can get all those data, but then if you want to link them together, probably it's very difficult. Similarly, our services. We have all those services around here. And also, they are working in silo. It's difficult to ask them to work together. So we have a family health service, Shirley's been heading that, and we have the hospital system is almost 100% free, and also over 90% coverage, and primary care is mainly private run, and social welfare. The government is mainly on the statutory function, and we have a good social network, safety network, and all that. The education, we are talking about 15 years of free education, right? How to sustain that? But then, all these are working, not linked, not planned, right? So the forum here talking about platform approach, how we can integrate and also coordinate investment, probably is very most relevant to that of Hong Kong. So all along, Hong Kong has been using a laissez-faire and also approach, right? So should we be more policy-directed? Right, so all along, Hong Kong is again working on welfare-based approach to children. I've been working on children's rights, so I'm arguing that we should be using right-based approach rather than welfare-based approach. Right, this is the budget. Probably you know that Hong Kong have a very low taxation, right, 15%. This is upper limit. Right? So Hong Kong is spending a lot of money on education and all that. Right? So in fact, the problem in Hong Kong, poverty, 20% in children, aging population, and also the economy, the political and all that is, the services is, access is, right? So it's quite comprehensive, right? So, but then we've been asking whether it's equitable, right? In terms of access to quality service, eventually to the health outcome. The other is the approach. Why should we be more interventional approach than just laissez-faire, right? You do whatever and leaving the responsibility to the parents. And also, should it be welfare-based, then the right base, right? So, and also, we have all those effective interventions available, right? The problem is how we can build political infrastructure for implementation and all that, right? So that's what I've been talking. Right, so I'll briefly introduce a few programs we have introduced, all right? The first one that started in 2005, right? This is coming from the previous chief executive, right? Saying that Hong Kong you should start having some head start project, right? So initially the policy address is talk about head start, but eventually after we call it comprehensive child development service started in 2006, right? The aim is to integrate the social education and hospital and also the maternal and child health centers together, knowing that in Hong Kong over 90% of our infants or children will be attending the maternal child center. The maternal health center will be acting as a good platform to serve this group of children. Right? So it should be an interdisciplinary and inter-specialty collaboration. And also in the design, right, the district council and committee and also play an important part in the whole program. So there are four components. So each step probably will be having a sort of a case manager. Right? The first program will be identification and management of mothers with postnatal depression. Right, we'll be screening all the mothers after 6 weeks, right, at the maternal health centers for postnatal depression. Right? Should they be having problems later on? And the second will be identification with referral children, families, or social service intervention. Right? And again, all those mothers who are on allowance and all that will be captured and also provided with appropriate intervention. And the third one is the working together with the kindergartens, referral and feedback system to preschool children with physical, developmental, behavioral, and family problems. And the last, but not the least, is identify the high-risk families, right? Those mothers on drugs, mental problems, and also teenage pregnancy. Right? But then all along, this has been a committee-based, right? So, and also, later on, I'll talk more about in fact, when we design all this, probably we sort of using a similar model coming from that of Professor Frank Oberke, right, in Melbourne. It's called a platform approach, how we link all this together, and also how we can mobilize the community to develop a good system. Right, so at the beginning, probably we think that probably the maternal health center probably is a good platform. Right, so we all along, the hospital pediatricians and the MCHC are working in their own, right? So now we say probably we should have a community pediatrician working inside the maternal health center. And also, we also have a clinical psychiatric service, meaning that a psychiatric nurse will be working in the maternal health centers. So at the 6 weeks, when they screen for postnatal depression, should they have the problem, they will be seen by a psychiatric nurse there. Should they be having more problems, they will be referred to the psychiatrist, and who will be also seeing them at the maternal center. Right? So that will serve. And also, all the system we try to link with the district council, the commercial sectors, and also the social welfare, the family resource unit. Right, so the process will be then all, because most of the mothers will be seen at the maternal health center and also delivered in the hospital. Right, so in the hospital, we will screen for all those problems, like drugs, mental health, and eventually, right, and also poor, referred to the maternal health center and seen by the community pediatrician, and also look for depression. And also we work closely with the other sectors, like the child assessment center and all that, right? So after a year two, Dr. Leung conducted an evaluation report and found that equity has improved. The effectiveness and the has also the efficiency and the structure and process has improved. Right, and also we're able to identify many of those who have depressions and provided timely support. And also identify substance abuse mothers. Most of the substance abuse mothers are on hard drugs, meaning opiate, and also, of course, teenage mothers, and also mother for poverty. And after that, right, this we refer to relevant services for support and all that. But initially, we pilot in field custodies. Eventually, this will be disseminated to other hospitals. And we work in Hong Kong, we custody them in the 7 clusters, right, anyway. Right, this is a evaluation, more detailed, but I'm not going to bore you with that, except that there's specific evaluation, like those on drugs. We're looking into whether the mother abstained from drugs for more than 6 months and all that, and how the social support network will be more responsive to them and all that, right. So eventually, we found that probably the postnatal depression, the detection rate is quite well, and also, in fact, we have served quite well on those postnatal depression. And also, the programs, in fact, is centrally funded, but then the local communities have a lot of initiative, right? They're working on their own. They identify their partners in their local community. So, in fact, many new local initiatives have developed in different clusters, like home visitation scheme and also parent-child enhancement, usually working with the NGOs, and also some are concerned about the new immigrants, and some are concerned about the learning problems and all that, right? So we piloted in 2006, eventually in 2013, is extended to all the districts in Hong Kong, right? So, but then the limitation still, the engagement of the public, engagement of parents, still probably we need to do more work on that. And this is the framework we hope we can develop, right? So, but then, to me, eventually, we hope that we can be more integrative and also interacting, right, in all those services. Now, probably we have a good platform. The other things, it's just looked at you, probably, and Dr. Yip is here, while we have been looking to the child abuse, right? Because we all know that the early child adversities have a great impact on children. So in fact, we have been trying to look at the problem of child abuse in Hong Kong. And we gather the database from the hospital authority and combine that with the social welfare department. Right? And combining the two, eventually, we can come up with the social child abuse at the district level. And also because we link the social welfare data with the hospital authority data, eventually we found that, right, so for those who have a history of physical abuse, when we check them in the hospital system, we found that especially for the sexual abuse, right, the chances of having suicidal attempt, right, is 5.something%, much, much higher than of the general population. And also the other, the next more important is child neglect. Right? So we can, using this data, eventually using the hospital data, we can identify children having a higher mental health problem. And also because of the GIS system, we can map it to the estates. Right, so eventually, what we have done is to present all this data to the Central Policy Unit, Social Welfare Department, and eventually, hopefully, they can use this all information to provide a better service and all that. So, and also, we have developed similar maps for the injury, intentional and unintentional, and also looking at the different child abuse traffic and all that. And recently, Professor Paul Yip has published a paper on suicide, again, using the GIS system, mapping all the areas having high incidence of suicide, right? So hopefully this data can be presented to the government for service planning and also for the local communities to for development of their own service. So Dr. Yip and a number of us have been trying to work on the like the Canadian and also the Australian system, whether we can develop some similar EDI system, right? To help us, because you can see that we have already found that those in the middle class and poor social class, right, they are on the academic performance and also learning has been difficult. So one of the things we hope whether this local information can help, right? So because my time is getting on, lastly probably I just briefly going go through some of the on injury. I've been working on the safe community and also healthy city, and Professor Lee has been working a lot on healthy city and health promoting school and all that. Right, and because of my interest on injury, right, so I'd like to develop a sort of a geospatial information system. Right, so basically capturing the injury data at the A&E department, right, using the new GIS system, we can use 25 minutes seconds. We can identify the site of injury. So eventually, and also using this coding and all that, right? So, and also with the geospatial system. So what we have found, in fact, we can identify the areas having high incidence of fall, high incidence of playground injuries, and also traffic injuries, child abuse, and all that. So because of the traffic is one of the concerns of the UN, so we first started with the GIS system on the traffic injury. So you have in Kaiqing, right, identified 10 hot zones, right? So after identification of the areas having high incidence of injury, we ask our road engineer to look at the road, right? See whether design and also the junction, everything, whether what's happening there. And this is the key features that have been examined, right? So on the pedestrian crossing, the lighting, etc. So after we identify all this, we present this to the safe community, healthy city, under district council, and eventually, hopefully, through the government agencies and also the experts on this area, develop program. Right, this is some of the sites we have identified. You can see that people walking, crossing the road, although there's a crossing bridge there, right, they never cross the road, right? So what should we do, right? So, and already identify all this, present, this is the one good example. After we identify this site, eventually, right, the transport department and immediately put up a road barrier. So just within a few months after putting up the barrier, the number of injuries coming from these people crossing the road has dropped. Right, so this is what I call using a collaborative multiplier. Right, so eventually we have the road engineer, social, and everybody to tackle all this. Right, so next, probably we just a few words on the playground. Right, so again, using the GIS system, we have identified the high-risk playground. Playground meaning having a lot of injuries there. So after identifying the playground, we asked a playground specialist to look at those. But eventually what we found, the playground in Hong Kong is very safe. Right, so safe that it's very boring. So to the extent that children are not playing properly on the playground, right? So in fact, what they are doing, they walk up there, jump down, and all that, right? So basing on that, we're saying that probably we have identified the 10 risk behaviors, right? And most of them are related to improper dressing, and also the way of playing and all that, right? So hopefully, after identifying all this, we work with the community workers, the kindergarten, and all that, whether we can educate them. Right, so other platform in Hong Kong, probably personally, help only school and kindergarten. To me, this should be a very good program. Right, the other is Safe School and all that. And also, we have developed a QK, a school-based program for high-risk students and community setting. Right, so for the Chinese saying, right, Sam Shui Ding Ba Sha. But this saying has been long ago, right? So meaning that the first 3 years determine the 80 years of life. And by 6 years, right, so and the development will be for all life, right? So to me, science is important, right? Research is important. And the knowledge synthesis, and also eventually the knowledge translation, and how we can disseminate this in multiple forms to the public and also to policymakers to inform police decision making. Right, so inform the public. The second, to me, is even more important in a sense, right? The capacity and also the practice, right? How can we build the capacity building, right? That all our workers are capable. And lastly, how we can develop an infrastructure, right, that will help us to implement all this evidence base and also and all that. Right, what are the gaps in between there? Probably, hopefully, later on, we can discuss more about this. Right, so the Institute of Medicine has developed the cost of inaction, financing, the platform, and also how to scale up programs, right? And also the platform, to me, another important, especially in Hong Kong, how we can gather all our effort together, right, synergistically. Right, to me, my experience on that, I'm just proposing, right, so equity and also their platform approach, to me, probably maybe a promising thing, right? So, right, that's my talk, right? Sorry, a bit late, son. Thank you.
I'm Andy Scher. I'm co-chairing the session with Albert. gives me great pleasure to introduce our next keynote speaker, Dr. Helia Molina. Dr. Molina is a consultant working for the Forum Investing Young Children globally and recently completed her term as Minister of Health in Chile. Dr. Molina is a pediatrician and professor in public health at the Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile. She is the past National Executive Director at the Ministry of Health of Chile, Chris Contigo, the Chilean Social Protection System for Early Infancies. Previously, she was a Chief of Healthy Public Division at the Ministry of Health from 2006 to 2010. From 2005 to 2008, he was a member of the Knowledge Network of Early Childhood Development, WHO Social Determinants of Health Commission. She served as regional advisor to child health and development to the Pan American Health Organization in Washington, D.C., and was previously director of Chilean Epidemiology Society from 2000 to 2004. And the past president of Chilean Pediatric Society in 1987. She holds a degree in MD from the University of Chile, where she specialized in pediatrics, and a Master of Public Health from the Universidad de Chile in 1990. She has many technical publications about early childhood development and infant public policies. Without further ado, Dr. Molina.
Muy buenas tardes a todos.
Good afternoon to all of you. I'm very grateful to the organizers for having given me this opportunity to share with you some of the experiences in Chile in the era of childhood. I will be speaking in Spanish, which is of course easier for me, but my slides are written in English, which would probably make it easier for you to understand. I shall briefly describe the context. We will look at the implementation stages of a program, which is not really a program, it is a public policy in Chile on childhood and social protection of childhood. An intersectoral policy which we have been developing in Chile since 2007 and which was one of the main pillars of the first government of President Bachelet. We will explain briefly what governance has been in our country, how we were able to administer this whole thing in our country, namely this intersectoral system, which has been operating from the local level to the national level. And finally, I will be talking about some of the lessons that we have learned and which have also become challenges and that I will be presenting now. Just a brief explanation, not quite as detailed as the previous speaker, but I'd just like to say that Chile is a rather small country. It has a population of 17 million inhabitants. It is a centralized country. Although it is divided in 15 regions, the central government is administratively decentralized, but it is not a federation of states. It is one single country. The GDP per capita is now at $22,416, which means we're still a developing country with a median average income. And although the index of poverty has been dropping considerably over the last 20, 30 years, there is still a major gap between the highest incomes and the lowest incomes. We have a Gini index of 0.50, which has been improving over time, but rather slowly, too slowly, we feel, when we compare it to the improvement of the economy of the country. Our child mortality is higher than here, but within the context of Latin America and the Caribbean, we are among the three countries with lowest mortality, infant mortality, 7.4. We are at a period where birth rate is dropping. There are certain things, for instance, 100% of births are attended institutionally, and maternal mortality is the lowest in Latin America from all those in Chile. Although for many years we were a low-income country, infant mortality and maternal mortality, as well as education, did improve over the years. In fact, I would say independently of economic growth. And this, I think, is linked to something which I think deserves to be highlighted, and that is that public policies in the health area is that we shouldn't, our ideal is not to always start with zero, but always make use of what already exists in the country, which is important resources. But very often there's duplication of efforts, repetition of initiatives, without integrating what has already been done before. And I would like to stress that in Chile, perhaps the most important factor in the improvement of our indicators is because we've had policies that last for a long time. Primary health care policies, important primary health care centers, services with well-trained staff at the centers. And I should say, for instance, that malnutrition or dysnutrition doesn't exist in Chile. Malnutrition for lack of food doesn't exist. There is a very small percentage, less than 1%, of secondary malnutrition caused by chronic diseases. Chile has also been facing the issue of obesity and overweight, and we are now facing an epidemic in that area. The strength of the public health system in Chile since that already from 1952, when the national health primary healthcare system was set up, has been improving. We started out, therefore, with a multidisciplinary team, which is a fundamental factor for what came later. We have followed this new policy of infant health, but as part of a system where the biomedical aspect of infant health was already well implemented, and what has been done with the policy which I'll be describing to you now is to incorporate a more holistic view, a vision of childhood. The development of children, the rights of children include those also, and the necessary intersectorialness to be able to work on human development from a start, understanding of what we already have. There's a lot of evidence of this. There's a lot of evidence of the importance of the very first days in the integral cognitive, sociological, and motor development of children, and also in the cost efficiency of actions that are done in those very first years of life of the children. Those are the pillars on which our policy is based. In 2006, Dr. Bachelet assumed the presidency of the country. She is a pediatrician, a doctor, and therefore we had a lot of support in working on childhood issues. She set up a council on childhood, of which I was a member, and we worked 4 months full-time to draft a document which was known as The Future of Children is Always Today, which is, of course, a sentence from Gabriela Mistral, the Literary Nobel Prize of Chile. And we set up there the conceptual framework of the national policy, which I will be describing. And after having delivered that document, which, as I said, President Bachelet requested from this group, it was then worked on by a group of representatives from 10 different ministries in the modulation and articulation on how to implement this vision, this policy. And the child that was born out of this effort is known as Chile Grows With You, which is a childhood social protection system, an integral system, which started off in 2007 with 100 municipalities and has been scaled up to the whole country in 2008. So now we have already had several years of implementation. The system has been evaluated, and we are now in a process of reformulating or strengthening all those aspects which the evaluation have shown are not strong enough, and trying to achieve better results. Now, in 2009, we adopted a new law approved unanimously by Congress, which also shows that the issue of childhood, when it is presented and when it is ably advocated for to generate necessarily consciousness among politicians and economists and so forth, that's very important also, as well as the people on the whole, the population in general, it is possible to establish and institutionalize and establish by law a system, a health system, that gives priority to childhood in all these aspects which I will be describing. Basically, it is a system of protection where the conceptual framework is the ecological concept of development. There is consensus that childhood development or child development is based on an ecological model which recognizes the multidirectional influences of the social determinants of health, of the environmental determinants of health, everything that is related to the health system, to the educational system, to the labor system, to the social legislation, and so forth. So it is a system which is centered on children, but which is based on foundations that regard not only the biological aspects, but also the social and the economic and political aspects of childhood. Another characteristic which is part of our conceptual framework, and which to a certain extent explains many of the aspects of implementation, is the vital cycle focus, the life cycle focus. When we work on early childhood from 0 to 8 years, according to the UNICEF definition, in Chile grows with you, we actually based it on 0 to 4 years, but after 1 year, we extended it to 8 years. But it starts out considering that what is done now for the newborn or prenatal period or in this first or second year of life are important foundations, fundamental foundations, to be able to build up the system, build up with the necessary bricks and mortar from the time of birth until old age, ensuring adequate human development and a healthy life. This is the idea of the life cycle approach, which is extremely important for us, because in the Ministry of Health, when I took over as minister, the first thing that I did was to finish off with the childhood program, the women's program, the adolescent program, the chronic age program, and therefore we set up a department of life cycle where we could work together all of those aspects which we know are synergies or are potentially have effects on subsequent ages. And this is, I think, what has established a fundamental element of the childhood policies. I won't go into all the details, but we did believe that we shouldn't be doing just drafting a nice policy, a very handsome policy in terms of implementation and of evaluation and of monitoring, but we should also try to see how can we approach this problem to see what are the determinants of the development for a child to achieve optimum development and to achieve a healthy and a happy life. This is what we want for our children, not only during their childhood, but also throughout life. And in that context, under the present presidency of Bachelet, we adopted several fundamental steps which made it possible for us to take charge as a country of the necessity and priority of childhood. And that led us to a reform in the taxation system, in the educational system. And we insisted on giving priority in resource allocation to these aspects, to these priorities, so that we could break the intergenerational aspect of poverty. Because we know that when children don't manage to achieve optimum development, well, in Chile, I didn't bring you the figures because the time is too short, but 30% of children, of vulnerable children, that's to say coming from poor families, indigenous people, rural people, more or less 30% have some level of delay in their development. Some are small delays, some are more profound. But in the children that are from wealthier families or wealthier, have more resources, not even 15% of them suffer from any kind of developmental retardation. So we have to overcome a great gap in inequality. And for this, we, in addition to have good quality, we need to have policies to reduce the inequalities, produce policies that allocate more resources to the areas most in need, and always based on a good analysis so as to obtain the best results. Chile Grows With You is a policy that is part of an overall framework of public policy of social protection of the workers, of social protection of the poor. And Chile Grows With You, therefore, is sort of put on top, is added onto this social protection system, but with a focus on mothers, on children and family, and with the fundamental purpose of achieving the highest possible level of development. What is what we discovered in Chile when we started to analyze and make studies to try and put forward this policy? What we found is that there were many programs, many initiatives, many pilot projects, lots of aspirations here and there, which sometimes fell upon the same people. Many things were repeated. So what we did, first of all, was to put together a model which could integrate all those activities and things that were dispersed, which were programs more based on the supply, so as to be able to create an integrated system that is based more on the needs of the children and of families. So Chile Grows With You is a social protection system which, with the main actors being the family, the various levels, municipality and so forth, the health system, the education system, the public health system, which are the fundamental axis. But we also have, of course, the influence of culture, of housing and other areas of the government and other ministries that have made us copy the slogan of the World Health Organization, which says health in all policies. In Chile, we have said childhood development in all policies, because there is practically no policy that leaves children outside. Accidents, urban health, as the previous speaker said, growth and so forth, all of these are influenced by the development of children and by therefore by the development of people. So the governance of our social protection system or social services system, which is a system to accompany families all the way from the birth to up to the 4 years, and now we want to go on to 8 years, is a policy which is centrally planned. So it is an up-down policy, but which is implemented at the local level and provides feedback at the local level so as to be able to re-examine, to re-look and rethink. So it is a down-up policy, but it goes down to the local levels. It's a bottom-up policy, which nevertheless goes down to the various levels of the region. The coordination of this ministerial at the ministerial level is in the hands of the Social Development Ministry, because we identified it as the most appropriate minute, because the technical ministries compete with it. Education and health usually compete. And often also don't make full use of the opportunities and the resources available. Therefore, there is a ministerial committee which sets the policies, the strategies, and the plans, and the evaluation models, and distribution of resources from a single budget. But so there's a single budget, but several ministries that execute the whole activities, with, of course, sectorial activities. And below the central level, we have the regional level, where we find the health services. 80% of the people in Chile have recourse to the public health system. So the mothers and the children are practically captives of the health system during the first 2 or 3 years of life, because of mortality, morbidity, vaccinations, and other services needed. So the services exist there. So the policy in the first 3 years is strongly commandeered, so to say, but not hierarchically, is the health sector, by the health sector. And then after the 2 years of age, the educational sector acquires greater importance, and there we will work more and more at the different levels of intensity, but always in an integrated manner. And finally, in the health services, there are special managers for this program or this whole activity. And in the central level, we have most joining of the various sectors and actors, because at the local level, that is where we intend. And I think it's very similar to what the previous speaker presented. We are trying to find the various actors at the local level to be able to implement public policies. So we can say that, let me explain briefly what are the strategies which from the Ministry of Health are being worked on in the first years of life. There is universal access for 100% of the children that were born in Chile. The most activities are developed for 80% of the children who receive their care from the public health system. And there is also an important package of intervention for the children of greater vulnerability, more vulnerable children, and which is are about 60% of those who are attended in the public health system. For all children, there are important policies of social communication, interactive networks, and all the legislative framework. A lot of laws have been adopted. We have extended a postnatal paid leave for mothers up to 6 months. We have established the law Chile Grows With You, and there's a whole project of working by day by day, so as to give more legislative and budgetary support to these activities, always within the framework of this global project called Chile Grows With You. In the health sector, that's where we have the most important program, which is called the Biopsychosocial Development Program, which has several things. A program to support newborns, which is very important for parenting. There's different programs. But let me just say that the most vulnerable population not only receives daily visits, but is also visited by a health team which manages risk factors, which have been screened during the first consultation of the mother immediately before birth, and a mother, if she has any vulnerability or if a child is vulnerable, is immediately attended and registered in all the various social systems that for housing, for economic support, for health, for mental health, and so forth. Maternal depression is also an issue that we are dealing with. There are also specific programs for children with special needs, technical support, educational inclusion, and so forth. Basically, what we want to try to show is that when a child or a woman joins or comes into the system, Chile grows with you, the biopsychosocial risk factors are identified, and according to those risks, the accompanying work to be done is different, whether they need a specialist or whether she or the child needs economic support, social support, or labor support. Sorry, there's something wrong with the microphone. So this policy operates with a system of registers and files that allows us to follow the development of each child and to see levels of warning or of things which should have happened. For instance, a child is supposed to go to a consultation, but we don't know whether it has gone or not. But we have all these filing systems so that we do can follow that, both the child and the mother. Some of the tools that this system has, as I said, the biopsychosocial development support program, which is provided by the primary healthcare system and maternity system and throughout the whole network of health services, and is administered by the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of Social Development. The program for support to newborns, which is also handled by those two ministries, the economic support, which is not only financial support for the program, but also funds are given to municipalities so that social organizations, non-governmental organizations, or other local actors can obtain resources to develop local strategies. There are also specific funds to strengthen human resources at the municipal level, because as we know, when you're working in childhood, it's almost a craftsman work, a person-to-person work. In other words, the people who work, both professional and non-professional, need to have the necessary competence and the necessary tools. If interventions, and all of you here know this, most of you here are experts on this matter, if interventions are not of the necessary quality, don't have the basic quality required, probably we will have no impact whatsoever. And these are the other groups. Well, it's important to say that the catalog of services that are provided as part of Chile Grows With You are always evidence-based interventions. Each intervention is based on literature which has been studied, comparisons which have been made, so as to not act on merely on intuition, but to develop activities that are scientifically based and that are based on experiences in similar contexts or in different contexts, but have been, for instance, by studying the program Nobody is Perfect, a Canadian program which we have adapted with the help of Canada so as to accompany people, the mothers particularly, during the period pre-partum and post-partum. This is a system that makes it possible to follow the trajectory, the whole lifespan, to see what's happening to children. When the health minister of health is developing all of this in the government of President Bachelet, there was an increase of almost 500% in installed capacity in terms of crèches. So to be able to increase the necessary supply for children whose mothers work, for instance, or who are children of adolescent mothers and who are still going to school. And there is no child in Chile that requires crèche that doesn't have it. All get attention. But of course, we are in a constant struggle, because not only do we ensure that the coverage is necessary, we also ensure that the quality is there. We also have a model of evaluation. We are evaluating the impacts, the processes, this satisfaction level of the users, so as to be clear as to what we are doing right, what we're not doing right, what people like, what people don't like. And we also realize that when we are scaling up to a country level very quickly, as we did, we find that there are different levels of quality in different parts of the country. And this, of course, affects the impact of this program. And we're trying to correct those things. I'm getting to the end. So we had a post-evaluation, and after that we introduced several changes, because we tried to get feedback very quickly to the various stakeholders, so that all those that might have any relationship to the development of this policy could know the results of it. And we were able to strengthen effective actions, focus efforts better on the most effective aspects, evaluate how budget was allocated and the resources were used. And also, we started to build up a new structure, so that during this government of President Bachelet, we reached the 8-year level. And among the post-evaluation activities, we also set up a very strong training program, because that is indeed an issue that needs to be constant, and it costs a lot. More technical assistance, development of the profiles of the implementers of this program, develop better technical guidelines or clinical guidelines, better protocols, create virtual communities for teams, improve the monitoring system and evaluation system, and in other words, improve everything that needed to be improved, in our opinion. And to conclude, I should say perhaps that we could, this is a very, very quick summary, but what have we learned? Well, we learned that some things are fundamental. First of all, political will. If there isn't political will, in this case of the President of the Republic, to establish a public policy and to so quickly implement it throughout the country without that political will, it would have been extremely difficult. So we think that political will, together with a plan of action, are the best combination that will lead to the best results. It is very important that there is awareness of the society, the community in general, of the politicians and of the professionals and non-professionals who work on policies of health and education, of the importance of early childhood interventions. When children don't vote, children don't speak before they're 2 or 3 years old. So we, who are part of this movement, need to be activists, need to advocate and bring about awareness, because once the technicians and the politicians are aware, then we can also expect them to work for childhood in this wider context of development. It's also important to identify that childhood development, early childhood development, is also an important social determinant of health and development outcomes. So what we do will have a strong impact on the rest of the life of each individual, but also of the life of society as a whole. So it's also important to recognize that social equity needs to start from the beginning, and that our forum, of course, tries to see how can we translate knowledge into action in an appropriate manner, and not little in just in little isolated projects, but throughout a policy in each country which will have an impact. This is the last of my slides. An intersectorial aspect, this has been mentioned a lot. It's in every time we talk about childhood, early childhood development, it is difficult, but an intersectorial approach can be achieved. What are the most important sectors in Chile Grows With You to achieve intersectoral integration? For instance, to share the conceptual framework, to be able to work in the same manner, and to believe, we all have to believe in the same thing, and to believe that we will achieve a goal, because we feel we, of course, can be diverse and have diversity in the way we approach the subject, but the conceptual framework needs to be shared, and we need to have a win-win mentality, because the fundamental reason why intersectoral approach works is because each sector is evaluated by its own indicators and its own achievements, has its own budget. So no sector wants to sort of push water to the mill of the other sectors. We all want to win. So if I win, you win. And we have to contribute in that spirit. It's also important to ensure that we share budgets. And we need to have political support to this work. So it needs to be a national level management on that aspect. My country is very hierarchical. Usually what is decided above then trickles down to the bottom, but it needs to have a certain discipline to achieve that. We also think that some of the interventions were not as successful as we hoped because of the intensity and the duration wasn't sufficient. For instance, home visits. The frequency of home visit was not as high as we had hoped, and that was because of lack of resources or budgetary resources. The results were not as good as we had hoped. They were good, but not as good as we had hoped. And we think important for intersectoral approach is that all stakeholders from all interest groups are constantly informed and receive a feedback constantly. We also think that an evaluation must be intersectoral, not that each sector evaluates individually, but the specific aspects, yes, have to be evaluated in the sector, but there also has to be an overall joint evaluation. And we don't think it's easy unless there is a good system of registration, of filing. Good information needs to be evaluated, and we think that sustainability depends mainly on the institutional aspects and particularly of community empowerment. It is important to integrate the whole life course, the context through the various social determinants, and also integrate the various actors from different sectors in order to achieve effective policies that march towards equity. And finally, something which is self-evident, but which we face the argument, no, in my country we have very high mortality and therefore we cannot yet be concerned about development. We first have to make sure that children survive. And we think that the best policies for ECD and for survival are the same. They're common strategies. So we need to break that belief that very often leaves without a strategy countries that most need them. This is basically, let me allow, with the words of Gabriel Mistral, the Nobel Prize from Chile, who said, many of the things we need can wait. The child cannot. Right now is the time his bones are being formed, his blood is being made, and his senses are being developed. To him, we cannot answer tomorrow. His name is today. This was written by Gabriela Mistral in 1948, when little was known about childhood development. But as a very good artist, she had a vision of the future, which I think is an example for us. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Hila. And I think for Hila is actually when I met her in 2006. She was a prominent professor, then switched to minister, and now back to professor. So we also have honor to have Professor Sophia Chan. When I met her, also professor, and now is our undersecretary. And to reflect, give us some reflection and remarks. And I think I just want to introduce briefly to my international delegate of Sophia. And she actually, again, like Hila, a very prominent professor, and was a professor in nursing, the head of nursing department, and assistant dean of the Faculty of Medicine of UNIS Hong Kong. And so you actually have a good example linking education and health. Apart from a PhD at Hong Kong U, so you have a Master of Education from Manchester University and Master of Public Health in Harvard. What better education could you expect? And she's actually an advocate for, and also great researchers in tobacco control, and done a lot of work for the WHO to train health professionals in tobacco control through advocacy, education, and research, and the first in Hong Kong to start tobacco counseling services. So I'm very grateful for Sophia to come because obviously a very busy time to Hong Kong with the budget and then financial, the budget finance policy speech earlier this year, financial budget, as you've been reading from the paper, a newspaper, we have an outbreak of infectious disease from time to time. So frankly, and we're very grateful for Sophia to be here. Maybe Sophia could enlighten us further based from our previous two speakers and with her own expertise and experience. Maybe I'd like to say a few words, Sophia, please.
Thank you, Albert, for the very, very kind introduction. Professor Rensley, Albert, and distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening. It is indeed my great pleasure, and I have to first thank Albert and IOM for inviting me to, attend the two very excellent speakers who have shared, their experience and also their insights in the child development and also in the child health aspect. Also thank Professor Rensley for providing such a nice college. This is my first time to be here in this very beautiful college at the Chinese University. Indeed, I don't know whether I am really the right person. Perhaps I'm not high up in government to really oversee the entire, childhood development. However, I do feel that the previous two speakers, Dr. Chow and also professor from Chile, has been given us a very, very insightful experience in terms of what is in Hong Kong and also what has happened in Chile. Dr. Chow has given us some statistics, very comprehensive, of what Hong Kong is like in terms of the different aspects. And the Chilean example, in fact, is very eye-opening in terms of having such a comprehensive strategy. And also, you are right about the political will and also the action plan. I do hope we have such a system in Hong Kong. So while we do not have such a comprehensive strategy for child development in Hong Kong, but I must say in the various bureaucs in the government, each bureaucs is doing their part in terms of education, in terms of child health prevention, treatment, and also other aspects, welfare in the labor and welfare department. Obviously, Hong Kong is a very unique context. We are like a developed city. We are highly urbanized, very densely populated. Hong Kong, for those international visitors, you may have already noticed we have a very fast pace. Many women are working, so they are working women. They don't stay at home. We have a large number or population of Filipino maids to assist, you know, the working women in their work. So these are some of the, you know, characteristics of Hong Kong. We do have poor people. The government have a commission on poverty, and in fact, after much courage, the government has for the first time drawn what we call a poverty line by this group of committee or commission on poverty. So they look at the various aspects. And one thing that is related to children is that they find that the most poor families are those with children. And so obviously the government, the quickest way to help these vulnerable people is really to provide some financial resources. So we do find that, you know, this is the case in Hong Kong. And if you look a little bit closer, you know, to not only the international context, but coming back to the local context. While, as I've said, the government do not have a comprehensive strategy on child development, but then we do have the different bureaucs and also the different commission. So we have our youth commission to look at the youth, overall youth development. We have a women commission. We have elderly commission. We also have family council. So all these are sort of high-level committees above the different policy bureaucs to really look at the overall, development and the various issues, in the community, on elderly, on youth, etc. But we do not, unfortunately, have one, on child development. Obviously, the family council include looking at, these development of childhood as well. If you come back to our bureau, the Food and Health Bureau, so we look at health and also food safety, etc. If we look at the development of childhood or child health, actually the Department of Health and the Hospital Authority has played quite an important emphasis on the development of child health. Obviously, in terms of prevention and also growth and development, the Department of Health is actually providing these kinds of services. For example, the maternal and child health clinic, the family health service that include child assessment and the various development, not only physical but also psychological. So not only vaccination, immunization, but also the growth and development of children. We also obviously have student health service where, that take care of children from school age all the way to their adolescence. In terms of according importance and priority, when I look at some of the slides earlier, you may or may not agree with me, but other than the prevention, if we look at child health or the secondary and tertiary services, in fact, if you look at the population pyramid, Hong Kong has a decreasing number of children, of births. So we have an aging population, but in terms of the fertility, it is decreasing slightly. However, we do have this new project that we have put in a lot of resources, the government, to develop the first children hospital in Hong Kong. So it is coming. We have already given financial resources, and we have already got the site, and also it will be, I think it will be in place in the next, probably in 2020. 17, 18. So this is already in place. So, you know, in terms of the government, obviously we have accorded priority in terms of providing resources. But whether this is enough, if we look at the overall context of childhood development, I think that is, you know, another question. And I think we have to sort of work with the different bureaucrats in order to come up with a comprehensive strategy. Professor also talk about some laws and legislation in terms of the entire system. I think this is important in terms of setting the scene in terms of these childhood policies. One thing I may want to introduce to you, because in looking at your different issues of childhood development, including nutrition, including, you know, education and so on and so forth. So I just want to refine it to pick nutrition, you know, as a topic, because, you know, we are currently doing a number of, legislation, you know, in relation to nutrition, in Hong Kong. To give you some context, Hong Kong has a satisfactory, I would say, ever breastfeeding rate. It is about, 80 to 85%, when people first, decide to breastfeed. But we probably have the lowest exclusive breastfeeding rate at 6 months, because WHO recommended that, babies should be breastfed for at least 6 months exclusively, and it can be up to 2 years. But we have one of the lowest, I think it's probably the lowest, is about 2%. So all the way from 80%, drop to 2%. So this is a very important issue. And I think as we have looked at both speakers' slides, they also mentioned about social determinants. I think there are lots of issues that actually have affected this phenomenon. Obviously, is the mother themselves, the education, the publicity, but it's also the aggressive marketing, of the milk formula, in Hong Kong, and also, other facilities, whether it is baby friendly enough to support the mothers. So, just want to give you a few notes about what we are doing. We have developed a voluntary code to govern the or regulate the marketing, the aggressive marketing, of milk formula and also children's food. We are also currently preparing a regulatory framework on regulating the nutritional claims and also health claims of baby formula and also prepackaged baby food. We have also just passed a law in the composition and also labeling of milk formula that require these things to happen. So this is all happening, in terms of policy. We also have set up a high-level committee at the Food and Health Bureau level in promotion of breastfeeding. So looking at the various aspects, not only, the milk formula issue, but also the community issue, the workplace issue, and so on. So I think, this is in a nutshell some of the things that we are doing in terms of real policy, but others that we are doing are more in terms of services. So I think to achieve what the previous two speakers have stated, I think we have to have this a commission or something that is really above the Food and Health Bureau. That is not, because this is really beyond what we can do, as a health, policy bureau. So, that is really an overall issue. But in terms of coming back to our Food and Health Bureau, I think we can do more, obviously, on looking at the childhood nutrition, because personally, I think, this is not well studied in Hong Kong. And when we talk about study, I think in many of the slides earlier, we have also mentioned about evidence-based practice. And so I think it is very important for us in academia, not only to look at service, but also to look at evidence-based interventions that is effective for the growth and development of children. So I think these are just some some of the things that we are currently doing in the government. And, you know, I actually embrace many of the things that have been said by the two speakers. And I hope, you know, with the workshop tomorrow, that when I look at the program, it is actually an excellent program, that there are really multidisciplinary people are talking about this entire issue on child development and health and other issues, and also financing as well. So I think that would be an excellent platform for us to further understand, you know, this issue and how that can be applied in Hong Kong. When I search the literature, I have this one quote that I want to end what I'm talking, and I felt that this is something that that really not only encouraged myself, but I felt that this would be good for everybody here. So I would like to read out to you this quote by the United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. He said, "I call on everyone to play their part. Success will come when we focus our attention and resources on people, not on their illness, on health, not disease. With the right policies, adequate and fairly distributed funding, and also a relentless resolve to deliver to those who need it most, we can and will make a life-changing difference for current and also future generations." And with this, I wish your workshop every success. Thank you.
Thank you. I know it's running late, but we still have some little bit of time for some discussion. Would I like to introduce our two speakers, and Dr. Chow, Hilia, and Sophia, and CB, please, and Andy, my co-chair, and then we start, please. If any question, any comment, I know this. I could see it's a lot of very prominent child health professional or early child educator. Please feel free to discuss. We do have a microphone, and if you want to, anyone want to raise anything, maybe? Hey, Lillian, not Lillian Wong, the practitioner of the Hong Kong Pediatric Society, please.
Thank you, Albert. So first of all, I'm Lillian Wong, a pediatrician, and also the president of the Hong Kong Pediatric Society, which I would like to thank the organizer for organizing this very excellent, you know, lecture and forum for us. Because first of all, I think Dr. Charles Chow has mentioned that, you know, introduced some of the data in Hong Kong, which I think in Hong Kong we will have quite a good data in terms of the infant mortality rate and also the mortality under five. However, we still have a lot of things to improve. Okay, and I think Professor Molina has give us a very good example how Chile has used policy to affect child health, which we think is very important. I think our society actually has been established in Hong Kong for over 50 years, and we are composing of pediatricians and also other healthcare professionals. Throughout the 50 years, we have three missions. The first one is to have a children hospital in Hong Kong. The second is to have a child health policy for Hong Kong. And the third one is to have a children commission. I think we have to thank our government and also the Bureau that our dream will come true for our first mission, that we are going to have a children hospital in 2018, which I think is very good for all the children in Hong Kong. However, we are still fighting for the other two missions. One is a child health policy, which I think, as Professor Chen, Sophie Chen has mentioned, that the government, there are different bureaus have done good things for the child health. However, I think we need a child health policy to unite all the, you know, actions, plans for all the different bureaus to, you know, implement our plan. Okay, as what Professor Milena had mentioned, the policy is very important. I think in the past 2 years, our society, together with the healthcare professional from the like the health sector, social sector, education sector, tried to work out a framework for the child policy. So we hope that we can submit this framework to the government for consideration so that we can develop a real child policy in Hong Kong. And the third thing I think is about the children commission, which I think we think is also very important. Okay, sorry. So I hope you can hear what I've mentioned before. But the third thing we are to have is a children commission, which I think Professor Chair. We have the commission. We don't have Children Commission, which we think specifically look into the benefit of children. Without that, all the things we are doing. Can you hear me?
So I think the last one I would like to make,
we hope that we can have a Children Commission so that with the Children Commission of Hong Kong, so that we can work better, to work for the best benefit of our children. And I don't know whether the premier to direct this question to our two speakers to make comments, and also maybe to Professor Chen to.
Take a few more questions and then.
Thank you. Thank you actually to all the speakers for such inspiring presentations. My question is to Professor Molina. I think it's really remarkable in the short time the kind of coverage and the system that has been developed in Chile. My query is on what is the critical role that families and parents play in the success of the system? If you could also elaborate on the ways in which they collaborate for getting the remarkable results that you have. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's take a few more questions, and we also want to take questions from webcast.
Gentlemen, please, gentlemen and ladies.
Thank you very much for our presenter. I think the presentation both cased from Hong Kong and from Chilean is very, very inspiring. By the way, my name is Ramsan from UNICEF Thailand Country Office, and I'm here with also a National Early Childhood Committee member and also the Quality Learning Foundation from Thailand. I think for observation. The first one, I think, model from Chile that you presented based on the people needs. That one, I think, is very on the demand side and really highlight what the importance of the very small unit starting from the family. And I saw from your diagram that you present the family support unit. You mentioned a little bit about the home visit. Would you elaborate a little bit more? Because you said also there are some constraints that that visit cannot be frequent. But I think somehow from your experience, you could have also recommendation if we really want to make based on the people need. And from the Hong Kong case, the president of university present and touch on the Early Childhood Development Index. I would like to ask also from the health, the last discussion, that you mentioned a little bit also that Hong Kong will move forward, and I would like to see to hear that how Hong Kong would take the idea of the Early Childhood Development Index from Canada into practice. Thank you.
One more question.
Thank you. My name is Erna from the Ministry of Health from Indonesia. Thank you for sharing experience about the early child development. Almost all the situation in Chile and also in Hong Kong almost the same as Indonesia. We also the president degree about the early child development. But I have two questions about how the implementation for the vulnerable children, how to counseling, the family counseling, and then how the implementation, because you until 8 years. In our country, we only until 6 years because they are in the community level. After that, we are in the school hub. Thank you.
Any questions on the webcast?
Everyone, I'm Seth Yama. I would like to ask a great favor of Professor Molina to share in depth on how you manage to have the one budget then goes through the different ministries, whether this is in addition to the sectoral ministry of budget and the subcommon, or how is it distributed? Because back home, this is a quite a big issue. Usually the parliamentarian, they said they have a sectoral budget and they don't have the cross-sectoral budget. Thank you.
Maybe we ask them. Maybe hear it yet.
¿Se escucha? ¿Se escucha? Sí.
Si no puede, me avisa para yo hablo en inglés. Mal, pero hablo. Ya. El rol de los padres y la familia.
You asked me about how the family works. In general, right from the start of pregnancy, a family includes both mother and father, and we involve both of the parents in a constant activity or work. We shouldn't say that it's workshop, but trying to incorporate the parents in everything that involves the process of birth, and that the father also participates in all the checks and all the checkups, health checkups of. Because very often the fathers, of course, are working, but we have created a system of work, where we, the health centers, work even after the normal working hours so that we can carry out workshops and have trainings and give materials to both parents right from the start of the pregnancy, explaining to them the importance of the mother-child link, of the importance of everything that's happening biologically to the child and to the mother, and how the psychosocial aspect of the family influences development, child development, and so forth. And that part of all of this is part of parenting, and this is important in the strategy, because very often, because of poor parenting, we find the problems of not only cognitive but also psychological problems among children. So I would say that there are a whole string of specific interventions for fathers and mothers and even the grandparents, because often, of course, when both parents are working, it is the grandparents, or grandmother at least, that are responsible for the child. And so we try to include in these working groups all those who in some way participate in the parenting. Also, some families are single parent families. So we look at the family as a diverse unit, as it is. We are only not assuming merely that a family is always mother and father and that's it. No. And when I talked about the home visits, I give it as an example. I think that home visits are among the most efficient interventions, because these home visits not only allow to see exactly what's happening in the family and what is occurring in the family relationships, but also is an important educational occasion. However, it's not enough to just have one home visit or two. We have to talk about four or five over a year. So what we have done in Chile is that because, well, of course, as I said, when you scale up a policy rapidly like we did, there are many things which don't turn out as well as one would like it to be. But this was a political decision we took. We, in the country, politically decided to scale up. And, of course, along the way, we noticed there were some defects. So we didn't want to wait until all conditions were absolutely perfect before we could implement this policy. And this is how we have had obstacles and problems, which we have evaluated. And there are very good interventions like home visits, which until now we haven't achieved the frequency we would like to achieve. So that's just one example. We could also talk about other interventions or activities. We have had quite a bit of trouble in bringing fathers to the meetings, to call fathers to the meetings, that they come to the various educational institutions. And for this, we have to try to find a new strategy so as to involve the fathers also in subjects which they often don't see or don't value as much as we think they should. It's important that fathers also understand that children shouldn't be sick, that children should have a fever, that or that what happens if they don't eat, and so forth. And the other psychosocial aspects that we also want to include. This is a task. It's a task we know is a long-haul task. As regards the question about the budget, having a single budget and several ministries, well, this is how it works. The policy was intersectorially planned. It's not something that something was already going on and the system was changed. No, normally child health is the Ministry of Health, but the creches and primary school are Ministry of Education. And games and sports are not health and are not education. So this policy is that of a whole group of ministries. And these ministries together decided that it was the Ministry of Social Development that would be the leader, that would take care of the budget. So we have a national budget, which goes to the Ministry of Social Development, that coordinates. And that ministry, together with the other three or four ministries that are participating, set up a working committee where not only they ask for the budget from the nation, but they also distribute the tasks and the funds to the projects and where they prepare agreements. For instance, we materials that are produced by Chile Grows With You are very good ones. They're text materials, music, other didactic instruments, books, and so forth. There are a lot of them, but they are quite expensive. So we saw that if all the materials, educational materials, were to be produced in a single place, it would be cheaper. So we produce all the materials together instead of different ministries producing them. Health, of course, gets a higher budget in the first years, but education gets a higher budget in the second or third year because they have more activities. So we work on the basis of our work plan, giving the necessary amounts to each of these actions. It's not easy, as I told you, but what needs to be done and also goes to all the persons involved is leadership. In my case, as a Minister of Health, and before that, as Director of Chile Grows With Health, the leadership from the President of the Republic, from the highest political level, is important. That's why I said that politicians are important, although they are very often scorned in many parts of the world. But it's because politicians decide many things. economists also. They decide lots of things. So economists decide what is the best alternative for resource use and so forth. So we have to see quite clearly, well, who are the actors that need to be engaged with us to carry through this policy? This is how we did in Chile. Nothing is perfect, we know that. Nor do we necessarily have we achieved the very, very best results. But we think, since the best is always the enemy of the worst, we should be advancing slowly, step by step.
I don't know what to say, right? So in Hong Kong, right, we have been advocating for having a child commission, child policy for many, many years, right? So in fact, Hong Kong ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child in 1997, right? So we eventually to report and the concluding remark also come back to Hong Kong saying that Hong Kong should set this up. But then probably after all these years, I couldn't see any signs that Hong Kong will be having a child policy. And also, why I mentioned the very good statistic of Hong Kong, when you present to the politician, elderly is my problem, not children, right? So you have so good health statistics. What are we asking for, right? So, and also, mainly the belief is that the children should be the responsibility of their parents. Right? This is still much in the heart of politicians anyway, right? So now with the rich and poor divide, to me, right, that is a concern, right? So especially when we are looking at the education and also the mortality and all that, right? To me, probably they will be widening if we don't do anything, right? So that's my worry, right? So having failed to convince the government, right, to have a central policy or what? So to me, the other thing is how we can, at the practice level, I'm a simple petitioner, right? So, and that way, how we can work better in a way, right? How we can set up a sort of a platform. I've been working for many years on different issues, right? To me, now I come to my simple way of doing is to having statistics, data, right? That will support the government and also the local people, right? How they should work together and having a common goal, right? Using this community empowerment, collaborative, whatever, right? I'm not fighting for the policy level, but then to me, the ground level is also important. With a good policy, without a good infrastructure, you cannot deliver whatever you want to deliver. And even more important is the building the capacity. How our workers, be it social worker, healthcare professional, teachers, right, they need to be trained, educated, how to work together. Right? To me, this is another thing. Probably that is also important. A few years back, when I talked to Professor Jack Shankoff, initially he has been on child policy. He's been advocating a lot and how to making the government, the US government, taking importance on early child development. Eventually, he told me, right, so even there's a policy, he envisioned that probably the workers may not be able to take this up because you can see that working together with doctors has been working together with nurses, except Sophia, for 100 years, right? So after 100 years, right, so there's still a lot of barrier, right, between professionals, right? So to me, the free section is also important, right? So the last question for you I need to answer is the EDI, right? Probably I'm not in a good position. Maybe Dr. Yip and also Namara can answer for us, right? Initially, we look at the other people I've been reading a lot is Fraser Master in Canada, right? And also the Mary Young, the group, they developed the EDI in Canada. Right? I think this is a good idea. Right? We have data on health, but then we don't have good data on education, readiness to school. Right? To me, that's as another important area. Right? So whether you can develop that. So initially, we try to develop the Chinese version of EDI and all that. Right? And also, we encounter a lot of problems eventually. Whether the government will take this up, that in implementing that, right? That would be also to me important. Maybe I know later on, maybe Dr. Yip and also Nemra can help in answering this question. This is something I hope we can develop in Hong Kong, right? So may not be the EDI or multiplication or whatever that will help us understand better, right, how the socioeconomic status will affect learning and also the cognitive and non-cognitive development of children, which are very important, right, for the sustainability of Hong Kong anyway.
Thank you. I don't know what to say to after hearing what Dr. Chow has said. It's a bit discouraging, really. But then I must tell you that Dr. Chow is actually not a simple pediatrician. He is a very senior pediatrician and also one that is very, very passionate about child health or promoting child health in Hong Kong. I have always worked in a university until 2.5 years ago. So while I represent the Food and Health Bureau, I cannot represent the entire government. But after working in the government for 2.5 years, I think when I look at the title of this workshop, I really like it because it says using existing platforms to integrate and coordinate investment for children. I think it is important, you know, for us obviously to have a goal. And what Lillian have said in terms of the goal, you know, the children's hospital is now materialized. There are other goals such as, you know, children commission and others. So this is a very noble goal, and we hear what other government, you know, can do. And obviously, with like-minded people like yourself, it is important for you to voice it and to give recommendations, give reports to the government so that, you know, we as an overall, you know, government can consider. And as I've said earlier, it is really beyond, you know, the Food and Health Bureau, because it is really above, you know, it needs the different bureaus to work together. And also the resources side, it is not as simple, and it requires, you know, political, you know, well, and also political wisdom. So my experience, very short, is that really one step at a time. And it is, I think, while we do not have the Children Commission now, it really should not, we should not be discouraged. And we should think about what are some of the things that the different bureaucrats, you know, can do and work with our partners collaboratively. For example, you know, education. I mean, right now, if there are issues that needs to be developed, you know, work with them. And for health issues, you know, work with us and so on. So this is the interim measure, obviously. But I think collective wisdom is important. So I really applaud Albert, you know, in putting this group together, and also IOM coming together to really have this series of workshops, because that, I think, would be a very important, or your final report would be a very important document, you know, for the government in terms of your recommendation, in terms of, you know, providing, you know, data and also the international experience for the government. And hopefully, you know, one day this can be materialized.
Just want some advertisements. Tomorrow morning, we will have a session by Limara on early childhood development skill. Please come to that. Don't miss that one. All right. Okay. So you will learn more. But I just wonder whether Patrick, do you want to say a few words now on early childhood? Or Patrick, do you want to say something? Yeah.
Yeah, Patrick Yip, a pediatrician from University of Hong Kong. Thank you so much for your question. In fact, as you know, early development instrument has been proven to be a very useful population measure of the school readiness of children. So that's why, since a few years ago, we worked together with Professor Rao and Nirmala Public Supplement afterwards by adopting a new Chinese version of the EDI in our local population. We start with Hong Kong, and hopefully we start in other parts of China in the future. And in around 3 to 4 years ago, actually, we have adopted two rather successfully on over 700 of children in the rich and the most poor areas in Hong Kong. During the time, we found a huge socioeconomic gradients between the rich and the poor children in Hong Kong. And we try to publish all those data and then to deliver the message to our professionals as well as the government officials in the past few years. And what happened in the past few years is that we have rather successfully followed up over 90% of the cohort, and now they enter into the primary school already. And then we visited all those children and then found that the Chinese early development instrument actually is a rather good tool with a strong predictive value of the subsequent academic performance of all those children in terms of their development in mathematics and Chinese. And actually, the well-being of the kids when they enter into the adopt in the local population in order to serve as a useful population measure of how well our kids being doing and also predict what may happen afterwards. And as you know, Hong Kong now is planning to have 15-year free education for all children. So I do believe this should be the optimal time that the government could consider to implement a reliable tool like the Chinese CDI in all those kindergartens in order to provide a reliable and scientific population measure for the well-being of all our kids. Wait a minute, we have another question.
So I think this is all the time we have for the questions. On behalf of the co-chairs, I want to thank our distinguished speakers this afternoon for sharing their insight and wisdom as well as experience. It's been a very informative session. And I want to just welcome everybody, remind everybody that we have an exciting session tomorrow as well with speakers from all over the region talking on a variety of issues. So please join us tomorrow for the session. Thank you very much.